So I've been watching the new Quantum Leap. Before this series debuted, I was low-key hyped for it. Well, okay, maybe that's overstating it just a bit. I was cautiously optimistic. The original Quantum Leap is one of my favorite shows ever. It was a must-watch show when I was a kid, and since the reruns were a near-constant presence on cable throughout my teen and young adult years, it really feels like it's been with me almost my entire life. Even though it only actually ran for 5 seasons and less than 100 total episodes. That being the case, of course, I was interested in the new series, which is presented as a sequel. The events of the original show are recognized as having taken place, so it's not a reboot, but none of the characters from the original are part of the cast of the new one, so it's not a revival, strictly speaking, either. But the advanced buzz, plus the hiring of a diverse cast of regulars, indicated that the new show would attempt to carry on in the same progressive, socially conscious spirit as its predecessor, and the trailers promised an adventure series with humor and pathos and some mystery and romance sprinkled in as well. Now that the show has been airing for a bit and I have watched, as of this recording, the first 7 episodes, I can say that it has turned out to be just that. An adventure series, with humor and pathos, with some mystery and romance sprinkled in. However, in terms of overall quality, it's been just kind of okay. Not terrible, certainly, but not good enough that I'd still be watching it if not for my lingering attachment to the original show. In other words, I'm not hanging in there with the new Quantum Leap because of how good it is, but rather because of my hope that it will get better. It's not a forlorn hope either. There are several elements already in place that could combine to make the new Quantum Leap into a terrific show. But there are also a few essential pieces missing. First, let me talk for a minute about the parts of the show that are working, and right at the top of that list is the cast. Raymond Lee makes for a solid lead as Dr. Ben Song, the leaper of the new show. Mason Alexander Park as Dr. Ian Wright, a member of the Project Quantum Leap team, has shown themselves to be equally adept at delivering quippy one-liners and bursts of exposition. Ernie Hudson brings a degree of relaxed, confident authority to his role as Magic Williams, the head of the Quantum Leap Project, and Caitlin Bassett as Ben's holographic guide slash girlfriend Addison, and Nanrissa Lee as Jen, the head of security for the Quantum Leap Project, have also done well, though their characters have left much less of an impression to date than the others. Besides the cast, the show is inheriting a solid premise from the original and adds a few tweaks of its own. The premise of Quantum Leap, that a person from the present or near future in the original is randomly traveling into the past and inhabiting the bodies of other people for the purpose of putting things right that went wrong the first time, is ridiculously complicated to the uninitiated, especially if you get caught up in the finer details of how it's supposed to work. But once you wrap your head around it, it opens up nearly limitless story potential. And the new show has done away with one of the limitations imposed on that premise by the original. Unlike original hero Sam Beckett, who could only leap to points in history that occurred within his own lifetime, usually, the new Quantum Leap establishes that Ben is able to leap back to points in time long before his own birth date. Since Ben is able to leap into anyone, apparently at any time in history, the creators of this Quantum Leap have the freedom to produce episodes about anything in virtually any genre they could possibly think of. This was also a strength of the original, but now, with the governor removed, so to speak, the story potential of Quantum Leap really is limited only by the imagination of its creators. As long as their imagination fits within the episode budget. Speaking of those creators, so far, they've been relatively smart about which stories they've chosen to tell. We've seen Ben dropped into a variety of situations, facing challenges that have forced him to use his head, his heart, sometimes his fists, in order to do what needs to be done so that he can leap to his next destination. And speaking of that episode budget, the show has looked pretty good. Sure, the episodes taking place in the 1980s look like they were obviously shot on city street sets on studio backlots, but that's what backlots are for. And yeah, episode 2 has what has got to be the roomiest space shuttle bathroom ever conceived, but come on, they've got to put the camera somewhere, right? So, the show has a lot going for it. Solid cast, a premise loaded with potential, it looks good, and let's not forget, it's connected to an established property with a built-in fan base, which is practically a prerequisite for a series to even get past the pitch stage these days. What's missing? One of the biggest issues for me is that while the cast is populated by actors who are likable and capable, the characters they're playing haven't exactly been lighting the screen on fire. Some characters have come across stronger than others, but no one has really popped yet. And that includes the lead protagonist. I don't dislike Ben. He's appealing. I don't mind watching him. But after 7 episodes, I still don't really have a sense of who he is. And I don't mean in terms of biographical details. I don't give a shit about that. Besides, another part of the premise of the show is that the leaper experiences varying levels of amnesia as he leaps from life to life. He remembers enough about himself and what he's doing to maintain a sense of personal identity, but beyond that, how much he remembers at any one time really depends on the narrative demands of the episode. When I say I don't have a sense of who Ben is, I mean that I don't feel like I know enough about his personality or his view of the world to be able to form expectations about him. I can't guess what Ben will do or say in a given situation. And if I can't form expectations, it's difficult to get too involved in what happens on the show because a lot of what creates our emotional investment in a story is how that story either fulfills or defies our expectations. On the subject of expectations, I don't know, when they announced a new show called Quantum Leap to be based on the old show called Quantum Leap, I kind of expected that the episodes would spend most of their runtime following the character who's doing the leaping. Instead, a significant portion of every episode so far has been spent in the present day with the team at Project Quantum Leap as they try to solve the mystery of why Ben chose to leap when he did and figure out how to bring him home. And look, on a certain level, I understand what the creators are trying to do by spending time with the present-day characters and giving them their own space in the show and their own storyline that isn't directly related to whatever Ben's got going on in the current leap. It's a way to set this series apart from the original. In the original Quantum Leap, we see the present day only extremely rarely. There are a handful of scenes set at Project Quantum Leap throughout the entire series. The action of the show is almost entirely centered on Sam's experiences during the leap, and the only regular character other than Sam is Al, his holographic guide. By bringing in some of the members of Ben's support team as regulars, the new show can avoid simply becoming a retread of the original. I get that, and I applaud the effort, but the equilibrium feels off. I haven't timed it out with a stopwatch or anything, but it feels like, in most, if not all, of the episodes so far, we've spent almost as much time with the Project Quantum Leap team in the present as we have with Ben in the leaps. And maybe this is just me, but when an episode has 2 parallel stories, and one is about a guy who's been thrown back in time to change history for the better, and the other is about a group of people investigating why someone hacked into their computer system, which has been a major component of the present-day plotline, I'm naturally going to be a lot more interested in the story of the time traveler and want to focus on that. So I wouldn't want to eliminate the supporting cast or the present-day plotline, but I do think the right balance between that story and Ben's stories is missing. Up to this point, the present-day story has been simple enough that moving it forward week to week should really only require one or two brief scenes per episode, leaving the rest of that episode to focus on Ben's adventure in the past. That feels like a better ratio to me, in theory. While I'm talking about things feeling off balance, is it just me, or are there too many characters in this show? I realize that earlier I praised the cast, and I sincerely meant it when I called them a likable, capable bunch, but I also said that their characters haven't really come to life for me yet. Part of that problem may lie in the fact that there are so many supporting characters that some of them have been left without very much to do. I realize that the producers want to have a present-day story running alongside Ben's weekly leaps, which is fine. I also realize that lead protagonist plus four or five member support team has been a standard cast structure for action-adventure shows and procedurals since the original CSI became a hit, which, in this case, is part of the problem. Giving the new Quantum Leap series this kind of cast structure does make it feel different from the original, but it does so at the cost of making it feel the same as dozens of other much more recent shows. It seems like a small thing, but I really think it would help the show to either eliminate or at least greatly scale back the appearances of at least two of the Project Quantum Leap members. Which two? I mean, I think the show has already told us. Jen and Magic have had the least to do and have been the least proactive of the regular characters. Though Addison's character has come across kind of flat, she is Ben's holographic guide through his leap, so she's gotten a fair amount of screen time, and Ian has been by far the most consequential supporting character besides Addison. Not only are they the designated exposition dispenser, they have also been the driver of most of the advancement of the ongoing present-day plot that revolves around finding out why Ben chose to leap when he did and what the various breaches of Project Security have had to do with that. Magic and Jen have spent most of their time on the show listening and reacting. I wouldn't want to write them out of the series entirely, particularly Ernie Hudson as Magic, who adds something to the show through his screen presence, if not through his character. Just start featuring them way less often, since they don't seem to be terribly necessary in the first place. Every episode so far could have gotten along just fine with Ben, Addison, and Ian as the tech person, and in most cases, it probably would have been an improvement, since dropping extraneous scenes with Magic and Jen could have freed up more time to spend on the actual leap. No disrespect to Ernie Hudson or Nerissa Lee. Again, I think they've done well with the material they've been given, but their characters haven't been essential to the series so far, and would probably benefit from appearing less often, leaving the show overall to feel less cluttered. It should go without saying that this is all hypothetical, armchair showrunning, if you will, and it ought to be weighed accordingly, but for my money, if it fits those missing pieces into place, better establishing who Ben is, centering more of each episode on his leaps and less on the present-day goings-on at Project Quantum Leap, and featuring unimportant supporting characters less often, and continues to play to its strengths, this version of Quantum Leap could grow into a very good show in very little time. There are already signs that this is starting to happen. The most recently broadcast episode, as of this recording, O Ye of Little Faith, was the show's best episode yet, and actually exhibited some of the improvements I've been suggesting in this video. The episode, a horror-themed story that aired on Halloween, sees Ben leap into a priest summoned to perform an exorcism on an 18-year-old girl supposedly possessed by a demon. The spiritual nature of the problem clashes with Ben's more scientific and rational perspective. Hey, the story creates an inner conflict that shows us something about who Ben is and how he views the world. Nice. A much greater share of the episode's running time is devoted to the story of Ben's leap, which eventually develops from an exorcism to a murder mystery and is a nice little horror story in its own right, with some lighter moments that allow Raymond Park to show off his comedic chops. The scenes set in the present day at Project Quantum Leap are also almost entirely centered on issues stemming from complications with the leap itself, with only one scene serving to progress the larger Why Did Ben Leap storyline. And aside from one scene where Addison has a brief heart-to-heart with Jen, the only Project Quantum Leap members to appear are Addison and Ian. It's really quite good. Good enough to make me want to watch the next episode because I actually want to see what happens. Not just due to residual loyalty from the original series and hope that this series will eventually start to get better. That hope is still there. And if the show manages to string together a few more episodes as good as or better than this last one, that hope just might evolve into optimism. At that point, the answer to the question, what's the new Quantum Leap missing, will be, appropriately enough, time. A few rare shows are brilliant from the very beginning. Most shows that turn out to be great need some time to get that way. The original Quantum Leap was like that. In the beginning, it was clunky, awkward, struggling to maintain a consistent tone, find its voice, and decide what it wanted to say. It took pretty much the entirety of its 9-episode first season to iron out its most unsightly wrinkles, and it didn't quite settle into the show most of us remember until even later. For example, the opening narration summarizing the basic premise of the show wasn't added until more than halfway through season 2. And didn't take its final form until the start of season 3. Quantum Leap was never a ratings powerhouse that first time around. It scratched and clawed and managed to hang on for a respectable 5-season run, during which it had a chance to mature, to gain confidence, to discover its identity, and to grow into a beloved and admired show that people remember fondly and, thanks to home video and streaming, continue to watch to this day. The new Quantum Leap might never be that good. Then again, it might turn out to be even better. I can't predict which one of those it will be, but I can tell you this much. I hope it gets a fair shot at finding out.